Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a complete course for the CCNP ENCOR, Enterprise Core exam. In this lab, we'll examine how UplinkFast and BackboneFast speed up STP reconvergence after link failures. This is the same topology as in the lecture video. Switch 1 is the root bridge, and the switch 2, switch 3 link is disabled because switch 3 is blocking its G01 port. Before we start, I'll enable STP event debugging on all three switches, so we can see what's happening in real time. Switch 1 first. Debug spanning tree events. Then switch 2. Debug spanning tree events. And finally on switch 3. Debug spanning tree events. Now let's get right into the steps. Step 1 says to disable switch 3 G00 to simulate a failure on the switch 1 switch 3 link, and then asks how long it takes for switch 3 G01 to move to the forwarding state. Let's test it out. I'll go on switch 3 and disable G00. Conf T, interface G00, shutdown. So immediately after shutting down G00, G01 becomes the new root port. That's because switch 3 is still receiving switch 1's BPDUs from switch 2, so switch 3 knows it can still reach the root bridge via G01. However, there is a 30-second downtime, because G01 still has to go through the listening and learning states. UplinkFast should enable it to skip straight to forwarding. Let's check by moving on to step 2. Step 2 says to re-enable switch 3 G00, enable UplinkFast on the appropriate switch or switches, and disable switch 3 G00 again. So first let's re-enable G00. No shutdown. Now which switches should I enable UplinkFast on? In this case, only switch 3. It's the only switch with a non-designated port. In a campus LAN network, you would enable it on all access layer switches, to allow their redundant uplinks to rapidly transition to the forwarding state after a failure. Before enabling it, let's check switch 3's current priority. Do show spanning tree. So switch 3's current priority is 32778. Also, note the cost of its ports, 4 because they are gigabit Ethernet. Now I'll enable uplink fast. Exit, spanning tree uplink fast. After enabling it, notice that there is a message indicating that the bridge ID has changed. Let's confirm. Do show spanning tree. So switch 3's bridge ID is now 49162, or 49152 plus 10. Also, something I didn't mention in the lecture video is that UplinkFast also increases port cost by 3000. So both of switch 3's ports cost 3004 now. Both of these changes are to make this switch and its ports less favorable in the STP algorithm. Remember, UplinkFast is for access layer switches. They shouldn't become the root bridge. Anyway, let's disable G00 again and see what happens this time. Interface G00, shutdown. So immediately after shutting down G00, we get debug messages saying new root port G01, and G01 moved to forwarding uplink fast. The transition should basically be immediate, or less than a second of downtime. You can also confirm with do show spanning tree uplink fast. As it says here, the number of transitions via uplink fast is 1. G01 just transitioned via uplink fast. Okay, let's move on to step 3. It says to re-enable switch 3 G00, and asks how long it takes for G00 to become the root port. Okay, let's re-enable it. No shutdown. So G00 moves to listening, but then look at this message. Root port delay timer active, and G00 moved to blocking. So this is another aspect of uplink fast. It doesn't make sense to immediately make G00 the root port, because switch 1's G01 still needs to transition through the listening and learning states before traffic can pass over the link. So UplinkFast uses an additional root delay timer. I didn't mention this in the lecture video. After the previous root port recovers, there is a delay before it becomes the root port again. The timer is twice the forward delay timer plus 5 seconds. So that is 15 times 2 plus 5, 35 seconds of delay. The point is to give switch 1 G01 enough time to transition to forwarding, before switch 3 switches its root port back to G00. Note that in CML, even if I disable switch 3 G00, switch 1 doesn't detect that the link has gone down. So switch 1 G01 was in the forwarding state the whole time. If I check switch 1 CLI, notice that there are no log messages about G01 going down. However, if these were hardware switches, switch 1 would detect that switch 3 G00 is down, and switch 1 G01 would go down as well. So this UplinkFast root delay timer is useful for avoiding traffic interruptions when the previous root port, switch 3 G00, recovers from its failure. So that's the UplinkFast half of this lab complete. Switch 3 lost its root port G00, but was able to immediately make its non-designated port G01 a root port in the forwarding state. Then, when G00 recovered, UplinkFast delayed it from becoming the root port again for 35 seconds, giving enough time for switch 1 G01 to move to the forwarding state. Now let's move on to step 4, the BackboneFast half of this lab. Step 4 says to disable switch 2 G00 to simulate a failure on the switch 1 switch 2 link, and then asks how long it takes for switch 3 G01 to become a designated port in the forwarding state. Now, since I'm using a new version of CML now, version 2.6, let's open another pane so we can see both switch 2 and switch 3's CLIs at the same time. This plus button here opens another pane. And then, I'll drag switch 3's console connection here to the right. So let's disable switch 2 G00 now. Conf T, interface G00, shutdown. After shutting down G00, switch 2 loses its path to the root bridge. Because switch 3 G01 is non-designated, it doesn't forward switch 1's BPDUs to switch 2 out of G00, so switch 2 doesn't know that it can still reach the root bridge. As a result, switch 2 declares itself the root bridge, and sends its own BPDUs to switch 3 out of G01. That's why we see these debug messages on switch 3. Heard root. This is switch 2's bridge ID, on G01. However, because switch 2's BPDUs are inferior to the BPDUs that switch 3 still receives from switch 1, switch 3 ignores them until the max age timer of switch 3 G01 counts down. After the max age timer counts down, switch 3 G01 becomes a designated port and starts forwarding switch 1's BPDUs to switch 2, which accepts switch 1 as the root bridge again. Switch 3 G01 still takes 30 seconds to move through listening and learning, though, bringing the total downtime to about 50 seconds. Now let's move on to step 5, which says to re-enable switch 2 G00, enable BackboneFast on the appropriate switches, and disable switch 2 G00 again. Then we'll confirm how long the recovery takes. So I'll go on switch 2 and re-enable G00. No shutdown. Note that it'll take switch 2 G00 30 seconds to move to the forwarding state, so there will be a 30 second downtime in this case. Okay, so let's enable BackboneFast on the appropriate switches. Basically, you should enable it on all switches. Actually, in this topology, switch 2 doesn't need BackboneFast. It's switch 3 and switch 1 that will communicate with the RLQ request and response messages. However, the general rule is to enable it on all switches, so I will. Switch 1 first. Conf T, spanning tree backbone fast. Then switch 2. Exit, spanning tree backbone fast. And switch 3. Exit, spanning tree backbone fast. Okay, it's enabled on all three switches. Now let's disable switch 2 G00 again. Interface G00, shutdown. Let's see how the debug output on switch 3 is different this time. Notice that after the heard root output, switch 3 G01 immediately moves to the listening state. Instead of ignoring Switch 2's inferior BPDUs until the max age timer counts down, Switch 3 G01 immediately becomes a designated port and starts forwarding Switch 1's BPDUs to Switch 2. Switch 3 G01 still takes 30 seconds to move through the listening and learning states, but it is able to skip the max age timer, saving about 20 seconds of downtime. Now let's move on to the final step, step 6. Step 6 says to re-enable Switch 2 G00 and see how long it takes to move to the forwarding state. So I'll go back to Switch 2 and re-enable it. No shutdown. After re-enabling G00, it becomes a root port in the listening state, and will take the standard 30 seconds to move through listening and learning. Notice in the debug output on Switch 3 that G01 moved to blocking. So that means that there is a 30 second downtime after Switch 2 G00 recovers, while waiting for the interface to move to forwarding. So although BackboneFast shortened recovery from Switch 2 G00's failure by allowing Switch 3 G01 to skip the max age timer, it doesn't shorten the time it takes for Switch 2 G00 to start forwarding again when it recovers. There is still a 30 second downtime. Before finishing, let's do one more show command on Switch 3. Do show spanning tree backbone fast. Okay, number of inferior BPDUs received is 1. It received that from Switch 2. Number of RLQ request PDUs sent is 1. And then it received 1 RLQ response from Switch 1. And then it transitioned to G01 via backbone fast. Let's use the same command on Switch 1. Do show spanning tree backbone fast. So Switch 1 received 1 RLQ request from Switch 3, and then sent 1 RLQ response. Actually, I'll use the command on Switch 2 also. Do show spanning tree backbone fast. Notice how the counters are all 0. Switch 2 didn't actually participate in the backbone fast process, which is why backbone fast technically isn't necessary on Switch 2 in this case, although I enabled it on all 3 switches for simplicity's sake. Okay, in this lab we examined the basic mechanics of UplinkFast and BackboneFast, including a few points we didn't cover in the lecture video, like the UplinkFast root delay timer. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching. Before finishing this video, let me thank my JCNP level channel members. To become a member, please click the join button under the video. Thanks to Jonathan Makura, Velva Jacob, George, Nasir Chowdhury, Gustavo B.R., Marcel Lord, Pavel M., Dragos Hernea, Zakib Shah, Mayor Salman, Vitaus194, Chance Carter 56, Mark Jackson, Bold1C1U, Michael Carroll, Gerald Guillaume, Fristas1207, Gabriel Braga, Hector Hernandez, Mara Tuba, Roji Kuriakos, Arpad Conives, 5 Feet, Owad, Daniel Brown, Jose Alvarez, Hussein Yavuz, Kevin Hayes, Samuel Tavares, Roger Bratseth, Mustafa Ersoy, Nasser Zahar, Brian Grant, Georgi Gemejev, Hypocrisy Allergic, Arlen Plagaria, Dear Diso, Adelson Pereira, Farad69, Joyce Njoroge, Lucien Stoichitoyu, Madmark50484, Alexandru Stratan, Hiago Bicalho, Pyotr Kaimov, DMJ2, Kurt Nell, Omid Farakesh, Steve Cox, Jasper Yim, Wilmer Romero, Laurent Lam, Pedro Hartman, Ivano Capuano, Enigma G, Jefferson Steelflex, Alejandro Okana, Burl Campbell, Abhishek Sahu, Toxic, Sinan Sarisenar, Gio, Daniel Andrade, Mike Crumby, Eliel Eliluli, Dragos George, Vijay Kumar Pili, Filip Jovanovich, Andrew Krauska, Random User 7547, Wagner Botelho, ICT EDU Official, and Mateusz Wzaszynski. Sorry if I pronounce your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. Thanks to you and my other supporters, I am able to make these videos and release them for free on YouTube, so I really appreciate the support. Another great way to support the channel is to like the video, leave a comment, subscribe, and most importantly, share this video with others. So, if this video was helpful, I'd appreciate it if you did any of those. Thanks for watching. Thank you.